Welcome to the June 13th, 2016 regularly scheduled meeting of the Midland Public Schools Board of Education. At this time, if everyone would be so kind as to turn off their cell phones, I'd appreciate it. Otherwise, they interfere with our TV feed. And at this time, if everyone would stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I would be happy to. President Branstad.
Here.
Vice President Singer.
Here.
Treasurer Wasserman.
Here.
Member Baker.
Here.
Member Frazee is absent. Member Gordon.
Here.
We have a quorum, 6 out of 7 members.
Excellent, thank you. Next up is item 2, which is our consent agenda. 2.1 is approval of the meeting minutes from the May 16th, 2016 regular meeting. 2.2 is announcing staff members who are announced their resignations with the effective dates. 2.3 is the request for a leave of absence for the 2016-17 school year. 2.4 is teachers attaining tenure status. Congratulations to them. 2.5 is the following books that were presented back on May 16th. Tonight we'll be voting to accept those new purchases. 2.6 is for Dow High tennis court rack repair. I guess those girls wore it out. And 2.7 was a state bid was accepted for an Exmark lawnmower with an adjustable deck. 2.8, bids were accepted for district integrated pest management. 2.9 is approval of the payment of the school system's bills for the month of April. And 2.10 is our legal invoices for payment.
I move approval of the full consent agenda of 2.1 through 2.10.
Right. Support.
By Jerry, support by Pam. Is there any discussion, any questions? All right, nope. Seeing none, all in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed? All right, consent agenda passes. Moving on to Board of Education matters, shining stars.
Thank you. Our first shining star tonight will be Rachel Walker. Rachel, if you'd like to come up. I'm going to read all about you, Rachel. So. Rachel earned her bachelor's degree in human resource management from Central Michigan University in December of 2013. That same month, she joined the MPS team as an office professional in the human resources department as an ASOP operator. That's our subsystem. Rachel jumped in with both feet, handling our complex, very often stressful sub-calling system at the beginning of every day at 6:30 a.m. Last summer, Rachel was chosen as an administrative assistant in the HR department following a colleague's retirement. In this role, she handles job postings, employee files, processing of new paperwork, and much more, including our recent job fair, which I'm going to tell you about. Rachel was nominated for the Shining Star by MPS colleagues. Here are some of their comments. Rachel has changed her schedule back to the dreaded early morning shift to cover for a coworker who is on leave through the rest of the school year, the most difficult time of year to secure substitute teachers for classrooms. Also, Rachel has been working feverishly on the teacher recruitment details, the MPS job fair, new databases, and interview prep for our largest hiring in recent MPS history. She is always finding new ways to streamline processes to make the office run efficiently. Rachel is a worker, one that would never know how stressed she might be because she is always kind and smiling. She deserves a superstar status. Another person wrote, Rachel organized a very successful MPS job fair in May for over 400 prospective teaching applicants. This required responding to numerous emails and phone calls from applicants, as well as organizing and overseeing the setup of the facility for optimal flow of the applicants to their productive teaching areas. Rachel did this while assuming more than her normal duties in the HR department during a coworker's extended absence. Congratulations, Rachel. And our second shining star is Chad Wagoner. Chad would come up. Chad earned his bachelor's degree and master's degree from Saginaw Valley State University, his bachelor's degree in elementary education in 2005, and his master's degree in special education in 2011. Before coming to MPS, Mr. Wagner spent 3 years with Buena Vista School District as a special education teacher. Chad began his MPS career in 2010 as a special education teacher at Midland High School, teaching math, learning strategies, survey of biology, and survey of physics. He continues in this position today. He was a class sponsor for the 2015 Chemic graduating class. Chad was nominated for a Shining Star Award by MPS parent, who also is an MPS staff member. Among her comments, she writes, Chad goes above and beyond by truly understanding the needs of his students and their parents. Being flexible and accommodating is more helpful than he knows. My son is enjoying math for the first time in 10 years of school. I really think Chad is a shining star and deserves to be recognized for his amazing work and students. Congratulations, Chad. Budget.
All right, we're out of the budget.
We'll take over from there.
We'll just wait for the screen to get down here. Screen to get down, room to clear out.
Now, since you got the comments on math, you might like to see the numbers.
Or not.
Thanks, I'll pass.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. As you know, at this time of the year, timeline's pretty familiar to us by now, but back in April, I went over with you the budget workshop. We talked about where we were heading and we talked about our current budget. We are at the stage, as you know, the Uniform Budget Act requires us to have a balanced budget before July 1st, and that's what we're working on, is adopting it at this time. The other thing I want to remind everybody is in a school budget, it's not advisory like most people think of it. It's more just an accounting of the use and the sources of the public funds that we get. And so you'll often see us, like we'll do on the 27th, we will go from the original budget to the one we amended in February, and we'll amend it one last time at the last possible date in June. And of course, then we'll wait for the audit to see how close we were to that last one. But that's the goal when we do a budget. So tonight is about the 16-17 budget, also the public hearing that will follow that, which is today, and then we'll do the formal adoption on the 27th, along with the final adjustment to the 15-16 budget at that time. So that's where we're going. So I wanted to start with just a little bit of where the revenues all come from. And one of the things we always talk about in the budget is the millage rates. And a couple of things, the 18 mills in the non-homestead shouldn't be a surprise to anybody. That's pretty standard, it's been there for quite a while now. But the second one down, the 1.6814 mills, is our hold harmless millage. And so that one, as you know, back when Prop 8 came in, allows us to generate so much money per student, $415.31 to be exact. And so every year we have to sit down and figure out about how many students we're going to have, what's the taxable value going to be, how many mills does that let us levy, and then it also turns around and lets us to either make up or give back if we over-collected the year before. So it's always that way. Started originally at about 5.2 mills. And it's now got itself to 1.6814. Right after we do this budget, we'll also be sending a resolution to the city because they have to split up the collection. We don't always split it totally equally, not easy to do, because we will have some variation between now and when we turn in the official tax document in September. Last year, so you get an idea, in 15-16, the millage for the hold harmless was 1.7766. So it's slightly down. Interesting thing about both of these last two millages here that we're talking about on the hold harmless, this is really the first year we've seen the effect of the exempted industrial and commercial personal property. Commercial's been there for a while. It's in our area, it's the industrial one that's big. On the hold harmless, the state will make up that part of the hold harmless that we lose due to that loss of taxable dollars. On the, and you'll see it when I show you the foundation allowance, the state will also have to pick up part of the share because we know what the foundation allowance will be, and I'll show that to you.
The local can't provide as much because that's been removed and it's exempt from us putting taxes on. But as far as hold harmlesses are concerned, we'll get that full amount at all the taxable value, including the industrial, personal property, and commercial that's not been exempted. The last one, which really isn't part of our general fund, but it's our bond, and we've always referred to it kind of like the 2.95 because that was our first year last year, and that's what it was. We got back our information from our bond consultants, and they're suggesting that we do 2.88 mils on all the properties for the bond. I know counterintuitive a little bit when you say the taxable values go down, because with a bond, you cannot get any of the exempt personal property back. It can't be taxed by the bond. Really, the reason that it dropped, and we did call and talk to them about that because it just didn't make sense, when they actually started the whole process of the bond and were looking at what they thought the trends would be, they knew, if you remember, we were the first districts that were encountering a bond and this is exempt personal property. And they knew that it was going to drop on us. They had planned on it dropping like 13%, dropped about 8.25. So the rest of the property, it grew more than they thought it would be. So the next couple of years are not dropping as far as they thought. And then after that point, it's going to kind of level itself out. But that's the recommendation. We did talk with them about, could you levy the 2.95 still and change some things? And you got to be careful when you're levying your millage to make sure you're not over storing, like you have a fund balance going with your bonds. There's a legal limit there that you can't do. There's only a couple reasons. So 2.88, which means when you see the summer tax resolution, there'll be 1.44 for both of the collections. But pretty standard millages there. Just want to update you on those to show you where we're at on those.
And Bob, for abundance of clarity, because when Mike and I went out on the stump on the bond thing a lot, you get into the weeds, and we try not to get in the weeds. But if people took you in the weeds, you'd be glad to explain everything. But tonight, I'll make it very clear to everybody listening. We were allowed to ask for so much money based on the property value at the time that worked at 2.95 mils. We are still only able to get from the taxpayers that stipulated amount of money. And if property value changes, we have to change the millage accordingly.
Yep, and as our consultant, that's why I have a consultant that looks at it every year as to where you stand at that point in time is for that very reason to be analyzed and make sure you're not overtaxing and that you're getting that amount of money.
So I was concerned if we lowered, would we eventually have to raise
it
above 2.95?
It goes the other way.
Which could happen if you had to pay your debt. But he is projecting this is safe and we won't have to do that. But of course, it is 16, 17 years out, and that's difficult to fully project.
Right. Then, of course, we have to make some revenue assumptions as we're going to put together the budget. It's a relatively quiet year, which I didn't know if it would be because the state kind of didn't agree there for a little bit, and then they came back pretty strong when they're in conference and came back. But the big factors always are the enrollment. So I'm just letting you know that our assumption is going to be that we will lose 55 students, that will come out with a blended count of 7,685. We're currently this year at about 7,740. That's the drop of 55 then. Our consultants and everybody else we work with and look at our numbers, it's an interesting year because with especially the Dow Corning, even the consultant that can't quite put a handle on what that's going to mean. So when we looked at the numbers, that would be Mike and myself, the agenda, Brian, our consultants have a low from 76.34 up to a high of 78.38 when they had us budget. They talked about 77.11. That would be in a normal year. Well, this might not be. We're much safer picking what we think is a safe number. Here to tell you, you can always go higher, lower. We don't know, but we feel that's a pretty good estimate of where we'll be. It's an interesting thing because we went this year with the same enrollment, and if you remember, that added to our revenues this year. We're not even as low as we predicted a year ago where we thought we were going to be. So it's and you'll see that. I'll show you some slides so you can see how the enrollment's gone there. We are scheduled to get a $60 per pupil foundation increase, and that foundation increase would take our foundation allowance to $8,351. That next bullet goes with it. When Prop A was passed, the hold harmless districts are restricted on the increase in their foundation allowance to the rate of inflation or the other amount. This is a 2x formula, by the way, so we're getting 60 and there'll be other districts getting 120. And so what they had to do was bring in a categorical offset payment to make it up, because if they would have held the hold harmlesses to the rate of inflation, since it was so low a year ago, we'd be looking at like $15 a student, which would take us way behind what everybody else was going to be getting. So there's like a $45 offset payment. It's going to be in a category, you've heard us talk last about 20Js, and the last couple of years we get 20F. This is 20M. Okay? A lot of them wanted to use 20J, but some didn't want to go back to that term. They just were afraid what that means. So they didn't. So you'll get that amount coming back. And then the last bullet point is an important one, but it's been pretty standard here lately. There are two forms of 147 money that we've been getting. One's a cost offset, comes directly to us, help to pay part of our portion. The other is a stabilization rate that picks up the difference between where they've capped districts, which is a high of 24.94, and they cap the rest of the way, which is usually sometimes another 10 or 11% where the true rate's running at the time. So that's been coming. That's the 147C money that's there. So those are both coming. If they stopped supporting us that way, that would be a noticeable amount of money. And so the addition is wouldn't be so important. With not as many categoricals now, so that foundation is really all right there. So you don't have the best practices and a few of those other ones that were out there. There's still some, but not like there were. And if you remember over time, too, I would just point out to you, remember, even when you see that foundation increase, when you take everything together, if you remember in the last couple of years, last year we got a $70 one that really amounted to 25. And the year before, I think it was 25, it's really minus 4. Mm-hmm. So you have to take kind of the whole budget there. And sometimes even as we go, like I mentioned earlier, there's still 20F money there that we're not quite sure. We know what it was used for this year. We don't know how much of that will be there. So could we off in revenue a little bit? We could be. We are on the low side. Like, we wouldn't get that and took it out, but it could be that's in there. So it's a little more complicated at times. Those major assumptions, though, I wanted to show you. This is enrollment. It shows you both 14, 15, and 15, 16, and where we're predicting for 16, 17. We kind of leave 2008-09 up there because it allows you to see the last year we got 20J. It's not our big enrollment year or anything, but that's the last year of 20J as a reference. You can see the last 2 years we stabilized quite a bit, and you can see that predicted going down to 7,685. We do think that this year you might wonder, well, how come we were off a little bit? We've really tried to analyze it. But it was a bigger kindergarten class, we would tell you that. And part of that has to do with the young fives that we added in, which is kindergarten. And the other part would be the secondary, I would say, just in a general statement, has not lost students as fast as the elementary. It was kind of people looking at classes saying, they're getting smaller and it's working its way through elementary. When it got to the secondary, it hasn't dropped quite as fast. I think part of that is because a lot of the alternative forms out there, parochial schools, et cetera, a lot of them still end when the students become a secondary age. So it still might be coming, and you can see some of it happening in middle school, hasn't gotten into high school, but it's not happening at quite as fast a rate. So that's where we stand now. The other one is the trend line, which I thought you might appreciate seeing, because when you see that one, you can certainly see it flattening out at the end, which is very good. I looked ahead at our consultant, and he carries this out with recommendations or at least estimates out to 2021, that school year. And even if I took the low there, he has us about at 7,400. I know we've talked in the past that, you know, we thought the bottom was somewhere between 7.1 and 7.2. Always hard to know at this point. You know, maybe we're doing a few things there, and we're looking at it. I would guess we haven't bottomed yet, but certainly slowing down makes a big difference on where we are financially. So you can really see that on that drawing as you look out. The other part we talked about was that per pupil foundation allowance revenue source. And so again, just wanted to show you that as you look through it. Again, it's the 2X formula this year. We got the extra $60 added on. Our hold harmless millage never changes. So you'll see that stay the same. The local millage that we can collect, remember, should be down, and it is, you see it, because of that exempt personal property. And so our share, remember, of that local that you can collect would be down a little bit from a year ago, and the state aid payment would come up a little bit because, again, we're going to get $8,351. And we've talked about this before. You know, they first, that's what you're going to get. That's your foundation loans. They see how much you can raise locally, and then they fill in. It's basically what the state does. And so when they exempted the personal property, the local can't collect as much money, and so the state's got to pick up their share. At the same time, though, I'd say that the 415.31, that is protected. We're going to keep getting that. And so when we don't can't generate that, that's where the state's going to make that part up, whatever we have. All right, so general fund is there in front of you, the revenue. Guess that's the first number you always want to remember, but about 78.7, okay. You'll see that it really, if I brought the same chart from a year ago, it'll look pretty much the same except the state's up a little bit, the local's down a little bit, and actually the other local revenues just up a little bit. So there's a little bit of difference of where it's coming from, but not a great amount. But it looks like our revenues will be $78,736.798. So then we come to the expenditure side. What kind of assumptions do we have there? We continued our balance, our budget procedure. We're doing it for quite the same purpose. Remember, that's kind of like zero-based budgeting where we bring everybody in from buildings, departments, anybody that controls part of the budget. And we really have them come in and talk to us about what are you proposing? Where are you at? We ask them to stay close to spending the same amount of money they did this year, but sometimes there's reasons somebody would increase it a little bit and go down. But it still kept us pretty much exactly the same as we were a year ago in those categories. So that part's really good for us. There are two things that are going to show up when I get to the actual expenditures. One is there's a decrease in the salaries and retirement accounts due to our early separation incentive. And I really mean by that is you are taking roughly 46 teachers, I want to make sure I get the number right, at some of the highest pay that we have, and you're bringing them in at much lower pays. So when you talk about salaries and the retirement then that's based on those salaries, even a little bit of the FICA that's based on those salaries, those numbers are all down. I think it's the best savings you'll see on salary for a while. This doesn't duplicate itself because from here on out, people will move up on their steps and scales and things will move forward. So it's a good year to save, but it's not something that can be duplicated year after year after year, as far as controlling it that way. The other thing is decrease in the medical costs. And there's really two reasons. Don't forget, we went from a self-funded plan to a premium-based plan. We did get some savings on the premium-based because part of that was they didn't charge us the full amount of taxes that you have to pay on some of those things. The company itself picked up part of it. But the biggest difference in medical costs you're going to see, they're going to run right around $1 million, and it's because we were doing the runoff of our self-insured plan. In other words, we are still paying claims today that were incurred last year but have never been paid. And medical providers have one full year to bill us for those. And those all go on the old medical plan. So all of a sudden, it's sort of like, I guess I'd my analogy would be paying two medical plans at the same time. I got to pay the premium to keep protecting people, but I got to pay off the part we were self-insured on. It's because we're self-insured. It worked the other way when we first started. When we went from premium to self-insured, we saved for a while. But that's so many years ago, it's not like we put that money away and said it'll always be there for when we end on the other end. So the runout is running Pornick with rebates, $950,000. It's Pornick over $1 million, which is kind of what we've had on an annual basis, and we still have basically 6 months to go, but it's getting smaller every month as you go. The big runoff costs happen almost immediately in the first two and a half months. Highest pharmaceutical ones right away. Most of the big ones are there, but you always amaze me. You go 3 weeks at one rate, and then all of a sudden something will pop up that somebody just got around to billing this on. For example, they always tell me if you follow the bills, the U of M hospital is one of the slowest ones to bill. So once in a while you'll get a big bill just because they just haven't billed you fully for the procedures there. But those two big areas caused the biggest drop in expenditures, and you'll see that pretty big. We do have all the positive effects. Remember, It is a two-year program we've been trying to run here to kind of get our financial ship in order. We're trying to make sure we didn't dip into fund balance as we go forward. That's really where we've been trying to get balance without going in there. And with the various employee groups that we had, affiliated and non-affiliated, their reductions continue to be reflected in the budget. They've kind of helped us get a strong footing. So that's in there too. It's hard to identify every little one, but they're all there, from the people that get furlough days to the people that pay more for their medical premiums, all part of the concessionary packages that we ask people to give. Retirement incentives or early notifications are lower. There's just a variety of different things out there that they've done. And like always, I think since Mr. Sherrill's been here, the staffing patterns reflect our process of evaluating vacancies, reducing whenever possible. That's without sacrificing opportunity and without sacrificing quantity. That's quality. We don't ever try to do that, but we try to look at positions and say, you know, could we get to this point in time by not filling that? And people don't think that amounts to very much, but as you've seen in the last couple of years in our budget, when we're getting the bigger variances sometimes, it's because we did exactly that. And it doesn't mean that we, you know, you don't get down the road and say we really need to put someone in that position. It just means that you're just being a little more cautious when you look at all of it. And it makes a difference. It makes a difference. All right, so here are the proposed expenditure changes here, if you will. And they're just divided into the various categories. But if you look at salary, remember I told you you'd see quite a savings. So you're seeing a savings of 1.6 million. And the benefits kind of follow along. That's where you're seeing the medical. Retirement shows up in that one too, so that's the 1.1. Purchase services is up, but if you put it with the supplies and materials, one of the things in changing directors of fiscal services is they all have ways using the school accounting code that they like to record things. For example, in Midland, she's taught me this in just a couple of months, so it's pretty good. She would say forever, we just keep putting postage, for example, into the category of supplies and materials. She says that's really a purchase service. And you really need to put it there. And if you record them, it doesn't hurt anything. It's not like it's wrong one way or the other. But that just makes it easier to access that money. But when you're looking up here, then all of a sudden it looks like, wow, we have to purchase services. But if you put them with the supplies and materials, it's really up a little bit. But it's kind of part of the cost of things that we have to purchase anyway. So it's there. Contracted services pretty close to where it was. The capital outlay is about the same. The other, the leases and gifts, that one's a little higher because as we look forward, that's where, like for example, our PYP, I'd say ongoing fees are gonna come from. We have used all our PYP grant money, so that's gotta come someplace from the general fund. So it's up a little bit, and some of that's attributed to that. And then just the outgoing transfers are the normal things that happen back and forth between ourselves and ESA and different places that can make a difference. But the bottom number you're going to look there is the one that's the 16-17, the second column over. It's at 77,675,967. If you just look at expenditures year to year, it's down about 2.5 million. Okay, and again, if you remember the revenues on the other side, that was at 78, expenditures at 77. So you can tell if you're sneak peeking ahead here, we're going to be able to have a year where we're not going to jump into fund balance to get there. Again, this is just showing you those general fund expenditures by account, and they're really just different ways to look at it. This one does it by the different accounts you'd have out there. So I'm looking at salaries, which of course would be down. I'm comparing this to this year's budget. Salaries would be down. FICA a little bit down. Retirement would be down. Medical the same way, some of the other categories not so much, but very similar as you go around. So like when I just went through that retirement a year ago was marking 18% and 17.2 now, or the medical was 8.9 a year ago and it's 8.1. So you kind of see where some of those bigger savings came from. If you're still thinking in terms of how much cost goes into personnel versus others, it doesn't vary a whole lot. We've been at that 85-86% for quite a while, and it kind of stays the same, very slightly, but pretty much the same as that you're used to seeing. And then if you want to take another look at that, this is by function, It's just another way to look at our expenditures. So this one's looking at, you know, how much went to classroom instruction, student support, instructional support. You can see where our expenditures are. And again, because salaries are down a little bit, the classroom instruction's down a little bit, some of that also ended up in instructional support. It's kind of interesting sometimes where those retirements and salaries differences come in, but they're in the classroom and in the instructional support. Everything else is pretty much the same. Building administration's up slightly because one of the things we did a year ago, in all honesty, is we cut building administration, Mornicki, about a position too far. And we're just riding the ship, and that's good for all kids because that makes them run smoother, and so we did that. Everything else is pretty much the same, maybe a percentage point or two, but not very much different. So again, you can see where we're at there. Well, everyone wants to see the general fund snapshot. It's usually the only one they remember after we go through all that, right? So you're going down there, and it's just, you know, where are we at here? The first column is really the current budget as we know it. Now, I know that's February, and I know 2 weeks from now, we'll then do something a little different because we'll know where we are in June, and the audit's going to come. It's going to tell you something a little different again. That's the one thing I would tell you since I've been doing the job that seems backwards to me, but it's all happening, and you're doing a lot of predicting before you know where you're going to be, and a couple months later, you know where you were. So I would just point out to you, when we had the adjustment in February, that's where we took you, and again, I'd stop you at the top, third line down, excess revenue. You know, it is very possible if we have what's called the budget variance there that we will not dip into the fund balance. But you need to know that as far as what's budgeted in February, we're still scheduled to dip in for $572,000. And if you look over in the June budget, which will be the new 16-17, when I put in red up here, you'll see that it's scheduled to have $1 million at the end of that without any variance, okay? The variance is just that. I'm gonna talk a little bit more about that because I wanna make it kind of clear. But as you look at it, the variance, we were predicting 1%. I always want you to know variance is just that. It can go up or down. The good years are when your variance on your revenues was wrong and you got more and your expenditures the other way. I love it when they do that. They can offset each other. You need to know that, and it has happened. And some people will look up there and say, oh my goodness, the revenues are down 893, what's happening? Well, you remember we were off on the students, and then we were on the students, and now we think the students are gonna go again. So it's everything we gained in the 1 year, which is great, it will be gone in the next set of revenues. So it's just this matter of kind of going through with some unknowns there. So you can see that an anticipated surplus or shortfall in both cases, the February and the new 16-17 budget would add money to our fund balance. And you can see the anticipated spendable fund balance at the bottom there. Now, a couple things and then I'll talk about it individually. I want you to know that even though it says spendable fund balance at the bottom, and I guess I think this is part of my job here, you know, we've made good progress on the financial picture, but I guess my job is to make sure I always throw caution in there. I'm like the wet blanket that lets you know. Things change in a hurry, and we've made some wonderful progress on where we're at. But everybody needs to realize that maybe it feels like overnight, but it's not overnight to get to this point. And if you're not careful, you can get right back to where you were in a very short period of time. So all I want to point out here is, when you see that surplus, you see that spendable fund balance. The surplus is just that, it's anticipated, but things can happen. That's with a variance. You can have no variance. Now, historically, we've actually had 2 or 3%. I hope both those numbers are wrong in the sense of we get more variance and we're putting more money away, because that can only mean good things as we look forward to that. By the same token, as you look there, everyone goes, ooh, you got that much to spend, and look at your percentages, especially in Midland. It is a strong possibility that a lot of that, while spendable, is restricted. And restricted means just that. Somebody has granted us money with a purpose, and we will spend it for that. We can't spend it for anything else. So, for example, right now, the biggest thing we have had is IB. What we're going to have is the STEM grants coming in. And so when you look at that, and I have it on the next page, but I think it was 1.2 million of what looks like, even at the end of this year, is in the fund balance to spend is not there. So you're dropping that 10.7 more like the 9.1 if you were actually looking at that. So I thought I'd just run three quick slides by you here, a couple, it's more than three. I wanted to show you the general fund history, and that's the thing I want you to look at. If you notice there, the blue's revenue, orange is expenditures, and the gray bar at the end is the ending fund balance. If you look there, any time that that orange bar is higher than the blue one, you were taking money out of fund balance. So people wonder, why do you want to have some money put away? It's pretty simple to me. There's 9 years worth of data up there. 16, 17, I think it's going to be a definite no with what I saw in the budget. But let's talk back even to 15, 16, where you're saying, oh, I think we're going to be to the good there. If you remember when we started the year, that's not where we said we would be on that. So we were deficits. We're going to go into fund balance with the beginning budget for this year. So as you look at that, I think it's either 6 out of 9, if I'm really generous, it's 7 out of 9, if I'm not, where the fund balance is what's gotten us through some pretty tough times. So I want you to know that there's a purpose to it, and I think when you look at it, I would always ask people, where do you think we would be without the fund balance? It really smoothed out a lot of things. We've been able to keep a lot of offerings that you wouldn't be able to do otherwise. So I think that's important. If you look at it more in a graph, if you will, I can tell you, I think I went back, and I think it was 98 was the high year at 24.16. That was the highest you've ever had in fund balance. You got a little blip in 03 to almost 24. And about the last time you were in the 20% and your fund balance was in 05. And then you'll see basically downward trends, and then it's a little jump there, but for the last, since 2011, it's basically been a downward trend on your fund balance. And in some of those years, if you think back to what was budgeted, where we ended up, that variance helping us be a lot bigger drop. Real nice little curve at the end there, though. I mean, that's something that's the positive part of that. You're putting some back.
That's the hope for a curve.
Right.
Yes, it is. So I just thought real quick, fund balance, again, it is important, and it's good to have it there. Do not forget, the state's early warning requirement occurs about 5% fund balance if you get down to that. And that means you're going to be doing some paperwork, and they're going to be taking a look at you, and if they deem you in trouble, then that's a whole other issue to deal with. We do not want to be there. Okay, let alone the manpower it takes to do that, it's what they control at that point, which we don't want to be. What's the appropriate amount of fund balance? I'm not here to tell you. There's so many different opinions, but I would think most people would get you somewhere between 11 and 15, depends if it's good times, bad times, where you're at. But without that much, it doesn't take much to go from 10 or 9 down to 7, down to 5. So I think that's more like where most people would, but again, that's a matter of opinion as you look in board's opinion. And then again, please don't forget that when you look at those fund balances up there, that yes, there's the non-spendable part. By the way, non-spendable is typically things like we bought a semi-load of paper, and they always run out just in May. You don't need a semi, but you can get a good deal on a semi of paper. So you do that, and so some of that cost goes over to next year. So it's spent, but it hasn't been paid out because it's into the next year. $130,000. But you'll see the grants alone sitting at the end of this year, 1.2. So there's a big amount there. And like I said, if you were to go up there, our February estimate would really be about 1.2 less than that, and it'd be closer to a 9% from that to start with. And don't forget, where we end this year is going to have an effect on that second one. Mm-hmm. Good or bad, we could have more in there by that time if people were going to say, well, he doesn't know what he's doing. That's the fluctuation that we're not going to have and not know until we get there. Those would all be good things in my mind, okay, if it goes higher. But you just need to know that that's there.
So, Bob, just to thoroughly understand that, right now with the non-spendable and the restricted giving that's going to come out, in terms of an unrestricted fund balance at the end of this year, we're looking more like a 7.2?
Yep, about 7.2.
And if everything came true in our budgeting and we had that same restricted money sitting there yet, which we won't, but we did, we'd be at a 9.1 next year.
Yep.
That's what we make
everybody
clear about.
That's where we start from, if you will, even though you're going to have a budget that looks like we're going to start from a bigger amount. That's what we
understood.
Do.
Okay.
Yep.
So we're in that 9 to 11% range.
Yep. The variance, let's talk about that for a minute. Both revenues and expenditures affect the variance up, down, or in some case offsetting. I think that's important. We are so used to historically, and that's a good thing, that we don't spend everything that we budgeted. get a little more money than we thought, because we try to be conservative. You wouldn't want it the other way, where you meet, you know, we had the 1 year, if anyone remembers, Mike certainly remembers, where we were supposed to lose 150 students and 300 didn't mm-hmm. show up. But now all of a sudden, if it wasn't for, I think it was buses we did not buy that year, we would have been having some big variances at the end that we wouldn't have liked in the wrong direction. Do we normally get 2 to 3%? Absolutely, I hope we get that both years. We're being conservative because it's so hard to know when we've kept them tight on supplies and materials, how tight have we kept them? And so we don't know what kind of variance there are. And our people are very good about not spending stuff that they don't need. So sometimes we get a nice variance coming back. The other part is, don't forget the biggest factors for us are changes during the fiscal year, student enrollment that doesn't follow a prediction. Mm-hmm. That's usually the problem. I mean, dropping enrollment's a problem. But when they don't follow prediction, that's when you really get some variances.
And this is a very fuzzy year.
Yes, very much so. And then the other part is the state funding change. And I would tell you that on the state funding change, if you remember, I think it's 2 years, maybe it's a year ago now, 2 years. They gave us 147D money, which we thought was going to be like $650,000. They made one payment, $150,000, and said, oops, we don't have enough money. If you remember, they canceled the rest of it.
Yep.
That's a variation that, thank goodness we were big enough, our enrollment stayed, but that could have been something that would have been very hurtful to the budget. So the state funding does change. We get new governmental mandates or rulings all the time. Without us trying to do anything, minimum wage, not saying it's not a good thing, but it's been marching up and we pay that, and it's been going up each year, so that's a percentage that we don't normally do. And they just made a ruling too on what constitutes a manager and who qualifies for overtime and not, and we will have some people that we'll have to watch very closely because they'll fall into that. They do not make, in fact, it almost doubled if I'm recalling right now. It used to be like a 23,000. Anyone that made more than that was classified as a manager and didn't have the overtime regulations. Now it's going to be like 47,000. So it's going to jump in a hurry on us. Those are things you can't plan for till they hit you, and then we'll just work the best we can. Major repairs, we've been lucky. Sometimes I wonder when I see some of the things go by, but we've been lucky not to have a real, real bad major repair. Put ourselves in pretty good shape with a little bit of sinking fund we kept, and with the bond, it's helped tremendously, but if you're not prepared for that. And I'm not, the special education cost, it's just because the cost of special education runs relatively high per student. So it doesn't take much fluctuation in the special ed population to send a cost one way or the other. And I put the ESA because they provide a lot of the programs. So it'll be all of a sudden, we're getting money from them or we're giving more money to them. And it can be just a matter of more students in a certain program. So it's still a variance that we just don't know till you get there. And lastly, the excessive revenue part, if you will. Let me take you back just one other time, too. And the variance, I want to point out one thing on this slide because I don't want to misinterpret it. I went back to get 14-15 numbers just so you could see how much a variance you get. And if you noticed, I took the original 14-15 budget, then went to the March adjustment, and then went to the audited numbers. So if you look at what we predicted we were going to have for a surplus or a variance and see how it changed every time what we ended up with. Again, those are good things, but it's just that volatile at times. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to point out, those are all numbers that we're not estimating anything. That's what we said in June of 2014, what we said in March of 15, and then the audit told us we didn't reach in for 3.2, we didn't reach in for 2.1, and we ended up with 493. Remember, that was real good news back then. So, but that's, again, when we put a budget out there, things can change, good or bad. Mm-hmm. It's just we haven't very often been telling you about the other extreme, like we're not gonna go in as far, we're gonna put more there. All right, then the excessive revenue. There's really two things I want you to know. And again, I just put them back up here. You look at the surpluses and you go, okay, we're finishing June of 17. It's the end of our 2 years. It looks like we're gonna put another 1.8 in there if we get a variance. I want you to know two things. When we asked employees for concessions, part of what we did, and if you think about it, when you ask for concessions, it's really tough to convince people what you need. And so one of the things we said is we don't want to overreach. We're not trying to penalize people. So depending on the employee group, it was different for every group as to what they gave and what they participated in this. We had, you can call it a budget surplus protection. You could think of it in the car companies as a profit sharing, but we said, listen, if that time when we run the audit after 15, 16, and 16, 17, we have increased our fund balance, a budget surplus after the audits, then we would have a very simple formula to return any excess of funds. And we talked about splitting it 50-50. 50 would stay in the fund balance. We would make a sizable gain on our fund balance still. And the other 50% then would be divided up between the various employee groups in whatever method. It depends which group you're talking about. Is it, you know, some is, when we get to that point, we'll talk about it, and some will be equally between people. And that would be like a one-time, you want to call a stipend check, or just a one-time deal. So when you start looking at that, you know, it's 1.8, we get a great variance, and it actually is more than that. That won't be the worst thing that ever happened, because without the employees helping us with the plan, that would have been a tough way to get there. I don't know where we would be. So I at least want to have you point that one out. And the other one, and I guess it's the part that worries me sometimes more than anything else, is the cost moving forward. Some of the concessions expire. I mean, we asked people to take furlough days. We said, hey, you can increase your medical copays. That was not meant to be forever. It was just, how can you help us reach your part of the give? And if you remember, that's what we literally did, said, here's where we are, here's our deficit, what can you give to offset that? And people did that. The teachers had steps and categories froze. So there's all those things that are gonna kind of undo themselves when we reach 17, 18. And additionally, don't forget this, I don't care which company we pick, medical costs, I've yet to see them go the other way. They are always going up, and they're usually, if they're single digits, they're high singles, and it's not unusual for 10 or 11 percent. So that's coming. A cost of living increases. I don't mean we pay anybody that way, but just materials, everything else go up based on something out there. If there's price index of some kind. And energy costs increase. Now, some of the bond work will help us fight those. But for example, we had a great year on both natural gas and gasoline, diesel, in fact. That didn't happen every year. So you gotta be prepared for those. So as you look up there, I was just using an example in my own head when I sat there and said, okay, if we ended up putting a surplus away of $3 million in the 2 years, that'd still be 1.5 that's going into the fund balance equity. And at 1.5 that gets split up to everybody else, which I understand. Now that 1.5 that went to fund balance, and this is the part I wanna make sure everybody's clear on, don't forget, something as simple as the steps and the category changes for teachers, a lot of them are stockpiled. That's not a bad thing, but they're ready for a category change. It's just been frozen on them. Typically, steps and lane changes, as we call them, are about 500,000 that it'll take. There's a lot of other category. I mentioned some of the furlough days in medical. I'm gonna guess somewhere between 100,000, 150,000 there, and then if you were to get a 10% increase in medical, 600,000. So again, I don't want to be the negative one on everything there, but I want to put a little caution in there. And I guess what I'm saying to you is we've taken some big positive steps to correct the budget, and it's really nice to be able to tell you that I think at 16, 17 with that budget, you don't have to reach into the fund balance. But it's taken, you know, 2 years of support from everybody, from the board on down to every employee group to get there. And, you know, if I could tell everybody we're not totally out of the woods without Grand Wolf, you know, when I think about it, what we would need going forward is you need the state to be steady in its increases, the foundation allowances. Sooner or later, we need a steady student enrollment. Or you need to hit the bottom. You got to study that out. And we have to have slow growth in district expenses. That means everything, at least in my mind, not just supplies and materials, but wages and everything else. If you get those, I think you can put together a pretty decent budget and move forward. And I think we've taken a big corrective step with those two. Before I leave this and take to the question slides, you know, it's impossible to put together a budget without everyone's help. It starts with the people in control of the budgets that when you tell them they have to meet you to build our budgets, they're not always smiling at you because they know that's a lot of work and they know we're going to ask questions. But I couldn't do it. My administrative assistant, Tracy Reed, especially on all the personnel side, the business office, Lori Holderby, who's brand new, and to walk in when she did, and we were able to put this together. It's taken a lot of work, but you don't do it with all those people helping. So it takes the business office, takes human resources, takes everybody's department to pull all those numbers together, and it's a crazy time. And if I didn't thank them, I get to talk about it, but they're the ones that do all the hard lifting and hard work there. But if you've got any questions, I'll be glad to answer them, but that's what your 16-17 budget's looking like.
Thank you.
It's encouraging.
Yeah, so I guess this time we'll open it up for public hearing.
Well, I'm the old guy, so I won't comment. Been around a long time. This is one of the brighter ones we've seen. You worry about the pent-up expense that's going to hit us in 2 years, and when the dam breaks loose, hopefully we're in a good position when that dam undoes a little bit. We can make sure everybody understands what restricted fund balance is versus the total fund balance. It's not all there. But it's nice that you said, Bob, we're dealing with the world's worst business model, a fixed cost business with a highly variable revenue. It's the worst thing you can do from a Prop A funding mechanism standpoint. But we've got the variables down pretty close now. If you really think about it, you know, on an $80 million budget, we're fussing over plus or minus 2 million noise range. Now, when you're on the edge, 2 million is a lot of money. But student count, we're not going to be off 600. And hopefully state funding, they're only giving you $60. They can't be off a whole lot unless they want to take a whole bunch back. So I think now we can manage the noise much better because we know better where we're landed. And I hope we get to stay in that landing zone for a little bit.
I appreciate the thoroughness of the budget, the whole process, and everything it took to put this together. I don't have any questions. I feel good about where we are. And the detail that you've shown us over the past 10 years in many instances makes me feel good about where we're going as well. I appreciate the caution. I feel great about where we're at, and I think the school, the administration, the teachers, all the employee groups need to be commended for all the work that it took everyone to get here. But I do appreciate your cautionary approach, because I think there's a lot of things we don't know that can happen the next couple of years, and I think all of Midland is kind of watching, so thank you.
Well, and I too thank you. I appreciate all the background. This will be the first time since I've been on the board that we are proposing a budget that doesn't go into our savings account. Thanks for explaining everything very well. I mean, it's, once again, as I've said before, cautiously optimistic, because we were just less than a year ago not sure if we were going to have to borrow to make our September payroll. So although this looks very positive, it hasn't been that long since we've been, you know, very, very cautionary. You know, I always look at this, and millions of dollars is just a difference from my home budget, so it seems like a lot, but we spend a lot too. And so although that fund balance looks large, it's not when you look at it as a percent of what we actually spend. And that's, you know, something we always have to keep in mind, that millions of dollars, it's comparable to what you spend. It's not the absolute amount that sounds so large. So I thank you very much.
Okay. We have one audience member, but
any public comments?
Oh, are there any public comments?
Not tonight.
Thank you all very much. Moving on, we have back to Bob.
Keep Bob on the hot seat.
Approval of our summer tax rate.
I just want to make sure I could pull it up fast enough here. as you know, the resolution, well, it's rather long. It's really, led to this part. It's really just a matter of telling the city how much would you like us to levy during the summer versus the other. So if I can, if you have the resolution there in front of you, it's some of it's pretty simple. It's okay. The resolution on the second page really is just saying take our 18 mils and split it 9 and 9. It will take our hold harmless millage, and it'll do it as 0.9 and 0.77 or 0.76, whatever that is. So 0.9 in the summer one is what it'll ask for. We're getting close enough as it goes down, when I can start switching to the summer one to maybe 0.8, but it's 0.9 for right now. The commercial personal property and real property is 3 mils. The bond will be 1.44 split in half for both of them. And that would be it. So you're really just getting a resolution. City's dying to get it because they get their tax bills out. And so they've been calling and wondering if we've passed the resolution just to ask for that much.
And Angela, your past practice has been to take a roll call vote.
Yes, yep. I do have that. So, all right. This time, do I have a motion?
I move to approve the resolution certifying the tax rate that is to be levied in the summer of 2016 on the property of the school district within the city of Midland. A complete copy of the resolution shall be attached to the original of these minutes.
Right. Support.
Moved by Pam, supported by Jerry. Is there any discussion? All right, if not at this time, Scott, would you do a roll call vote?
Yes. President Branstad?
Yes.
Vice President Singer?
Yes.
I vote yes. Treasurer Wasserman?
Yes.
Member Baker?
Yes.
Member Gordon?
Yes.
We have one absent member and 7 yes votes.
Six. All right. Thank you very much, Scott. All right. Send that to the city. All right. Moving on. Item 4.2 is MHSAA, and that's...
So you've been doing this for nearly 40 years now.
Mm-hmm.
It allows our four secondary schools to be members of the Michigan High School Athletic Association. You'll follow their rules and their guidelines as you go forward. And your past practice here as well has been to take a roll call vote.
Yes.
Correct, Cindy?
Yes.
Not sure why, but we better stay there.
Yeah, because of resolution. If it's a resolution, board resolutions are done by roll call. Yeah.
All right, let's get it right this time. President Branstad.
No, we have to go through the whole other part of it.
Got to do the motion.
I thought Mike was just explaining it.
The motion sorry, that's all right.
I move the Board of Education to adopt the MHSAA resolution for the two Midland Public Schools middle schools and two high schools for the 2016-17 school year. A complete copy of the resolution shall be attached to the original of these minutes.
Support. Again, support. Oops, Lynn got it.
All right, moved by Yvonne, supported by Lynn. Is there any discussion?
Nope.
All right, like Mike said, this is something we do every single year. All right, Scott.
Okay, President Branstad.
Yes.
Vice President Singer.
Yes.
I say yes. Treasurer Wasserman.
Yes.
Member Baker.
Yes.
Member Gordon.
Yes.
6 yes, 1 absent.
Excellent, thank you very much. Moving on, let's see. Back to you, Bob.
And back to me. Yeah. What we have for you in 4.3 is the Meal Magic Suite purchase, and it's really software for our food service department to use. The current software we use for point of sales and different parts is pretty antiquated, and this is really the program out there that's being used. Provides lots of efficiencies, not only for the food program, but for the parents and everybody else involved. Quicker, we can account for things on a more regular basis. They did extensive research with the tech department, making sure that we picked something that made sense. It comes with good training, being used lots of places, including many places where Chartwell's always is. I guess in general, you'll see the cost, and we're asking for approval tonight. Dave D6 here, if we had a question or anything, but I think this is a software package, pretty straightforward. But you do, Dave would want to be able to have a little more details for you.
Do you want to do the motion first? Because I do have a question.
Okay. Do the motion. So if someone would like to.
I motion to approve item 4.3, Meal Magic Suite purchase.
All right.
I'll support that.
All right, moved by Pam, supported by Yvonne. Is there any discussion?
Now I'll be the bad guy to ask the question. Is there parental interface to this? You know, to load money and do that sort of thing? Is there functionality that our parents have to learn? Okay, so they don't see a change.
They won't see a change in the new software interfaces with school network, which is what we're
okay. That was my big solace. No, I heard about training and my antenna went up.
Training is strictly for the food services personnel, the staff running the registers, and then for the tech staff.
Perfect, thank you.
Parents will be very happy with this product. Yeah. It's very nice to use.
If they don't interface with it, how will they be happy with it? I guess what is...
They do interface.
What is different?
The parents will interface the same as they always have at the school management. They also, anybody that's doing the free and reduced application and the certification, that process is much better.
Much easier, okay.
Okay, and they don't need to be trained, and I mean, it'll be obvious to them?
Correct.
Okay.
They're already doing it.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, even I can use Bill Pay.
I use it all the time, that's what I was...
I'm the one to ask the question?
As parents. All right, is there any more discussion? All right, if not, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? All right, passes 6-0. All right, next up is me. So at this time, we're back to, it's been, and I can't even remember, have you been here 3 years or 4 years?
3 years.
3 years, that is amazing. It seems like yesterday that we went through
our whole
process to interviewing. And so at the time we brought you in, just so people know, you are here on a contract.
Correct.
And so you have a 5-year contract with us. And so every year we extend it if we so choose to. And so it's my pleasure to bring...
Or roll it back on. So as the year comes off, it might be the better way to say it.
Okay, yeah. So we roll. So it's a rolling 5-year contract.
Yeah, so it's down to 4 now.
Right. So right now the contract goes through 2021 or 2020. And so tonight I bring before the rest of the board a contract to roll it through to 2021. Am I phrasing that right?
Correct.
Yes. So the contract this year, last year, you took some concessions, as did everybody in the district. And so this year, we will just stay with those same concessions, hold it the same as last year. And so it's my privilege to bring it before the rest of the board today. We, as you know, we evaluate you at the end of the year. A lot of that is because sometimes we have board turnover in January with the election cycle, so we like to do that with the current board able to do your evaluation. And we, once again, are very pleased with your performance. It's been great. You know, as we just saw now, we've had a lot of financial challenges and you've met those head on, and we really appreciate that. And earlier tonight, some of us went and got to tour Central, the new Central Park Elementary School, and that's just a piece of what we're doing with these bond funds that you and many other people work so hard to secure for the district. And it's very, very exciting. And I'm just very excited moving forward, and I appreciate all the hard work that you've done. So at this time, take a motion.
I will be happy to move that we extend Mike's contract.
And I'll be more than happy to support.
All right, moved by Scott, supported by Jerry. Is there any other discussion questions?
It has been a very fast 3 years. A very fast paced. And you know, you just look at where we were at and where we're at now and where we're going to be the next couple of years, and it's very exciting. STEM's coming to all of our elementaries and the rest and the upper levels, new buildings, refreshed buildings, balanced budget, structural change to things that will keep us stable. Yes, Mike, I'm more than glad to put on another year. And if you can't leave, until so.
I don't plan on it either.
So. Yeah, we've made it through. We're going to see all the exciting stuff as it comes to fruition here.
Absolutely. I support all those comments, yes. Man. Absolutely. I do too, and appreciate all that you've done for the school district.
I think... you know, I certainly appreciate it, and I think all of the team that does most of that day-to-day running, I often say I'm the guy who barges in their offices with ideas, and they go get it done for me, so they appreciate it too, I'm sure.
They may not appreciate the barging in.
You know. They probably don't.
All right, at this time, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right.
Sounds unanimous.
Yep, thank you very much, Mike.
You're welcome. Thank you, Mike.
All right, moving on. Request to address the board. Would anyone like to address the board tonight? Did we have anyone? No, okay. No hearings have been requested. But all right, moving on then to curriculum instruction and assessment. I will turn it over to Brian.
Yep, item 6.1 we bring to you for information tonight
13 total plans between the district and the school improvement plan. You have your 11 buildings, and you also have to factor in the JCC as well, mm-hmm. too. They're mandated by the state to submit a plan in addition to the district plan. And the buildings have been working hard on these since the late winter, as well as the district curriculum team as well, too. A quick reminder that all of these plans have gone through a review process through our district school improvement committee. That commenced a couple of weeks back, and we have listened to the feedback from the district school improvement committee, made adjustments to it, and tonight these are brought to you for information only. So if anyone from the public would like to view these 13 plans, they're available in my office, and we'd be happy to walk them through those plans, and we'll bring those back to you on the 18th of July for action and for approval. Item 6.2, we're bringing to you six more books this evening for the 28-day review period. A new science text for our IBAP biology, three novels that correlate to our English 9 and 9A curriculum, and also two resource books for IB 20th Century World Topics. Those are all located outside of my office, and again, happy to review those with anyone in the public that would like to look at those materials. Those will be brought for action in the July board meeting and will be purchased only with availability of the district funds.
Excellent, thank you. All right, moving on, FFO. So we did have a meeting. Jerry.
Oh, we did, that's right. Sorry. Yes, we just met last Monday.
Yes, we did.
You can see in the minutes out in the hallway, by the way, wants to read them. We reviewed job safety on the project at the Central Elementary. Mr. Don Brow from Barton Marlowe shared the information on how the construction management company handled job safety procedures and practices in place to emphasize safety on the work site. And then for the auditorium, new news on the auditorium is Mr. Don Brow and Mr. Jerome from French Associates reviewed with the committee the progress and timeline of the auditorium renovations and rough review of the latest cost estimates. And they are working with the different affinity groups to finalize plans to get a more definitive definition of the scope. Mr. Cooper and committee members discussed the following, the 16-17 proposed budget we saw this evening, and the upcoming summer tax resolution that we voted on this evening. Our next FFO meeting will be Monday, July 11th at 5 p.m.
No, we talked about that tonight. We're okay. Doing things, don't we? Daryl has promised us some fabulous progress at Central by then. All right, next item 7.2. Back to you, Bob.
I have 7.2 tonight just for information gifts, actually 14 of them, totaling $15,406.73. You'll see that some of them are numerous gifts from different entities, the Midland Area Community Foundation, Kiwanis Foundation, Dalhai All Sports Boosters, and the JPAC, the Jefferson Parent Advisory Committee, along with, there's a gift from Think Energy Program to Adams School. East Lawn has a gift for a field trip from Mr. and Mrs. Cal Getters. And we also have some from the Midland High Boosters Club for spring tournament entry fees. I do have two gifts under 7.3. that require your action, though they total $41,900. There's a gift, $25,000 from the Gerstacker Foundation for the Distinguished Service Award Program. They're a strong supporter of that, and they're just granting that money to us so we can continue. And then Plymouth Elementary PTO has a gift there for their teachers, $16,900. And because of the size of those two gifts, those require your approval.
Remind me, do we do them as one or separate?
You've done them together before, okay. So that's okay. Not a problem.
I move the approval of section 7.3.
Support.
All right. Moved by Jerry, supported by Scott. Is there any discussion?
Thank you.
Absolutely. It is wonderful.
Once again,
wonderful.
Trying to do the math. What is that? $57,000? Yeah, it's just amazing.
Very blessed.
Yes. Covering a wide range of
stuff.
Sports and science and all kinds of different things. All right. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right. Passes. Moving on to human resources, Mike.
Not a lot going on there, but we do have a retirement. This is Carol Hopkins, office professional at the Juvenile Care Center. Will be retiring on June 24th.
Item 9 is correspondence to and from the Board of Education. You can see all those as printed in the agenda. 10 is scheduled activities. Our next board meeting will be June 27th. This is one of the months that we have the two, and a lot of that, you know, goes along with the budget that we just discussed. So everyone will definitely want to tune in to the next one. And at this time, moving on to item 11, which is our study discussion session. So I think I will start with you, Lynn.
Well, I would like to congratulate the graduates. The commencement, other than being quite warm, was lovely, and the speakers are always very impressive. And the kids are so excited to switch that tassel and ready to move on. So thank you for everybody. I know that that is involved because it takes a lot of a lot of planning to get that many students in line. And Bob, thank you for always doing a budget presentation that is pretty easy to understand. So I thank you and all those people that are involved with that. And congratulations to Rachel and Chad on their Shining Star Awards. Those are always fun to see. And I, at this point, I guess a couple, three more days of school, and have a great summer.
Again, yeah, congratulations to the graduates, and more importantly, congratulations on being safe. The best I can tell from news reports, we haven't had any tragedies or near tragedies involving graduation activities, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm just so glad we get that the safety's out there and we're not having tragedy on top of what should be a joyous occasions. And also congratulations, something near and dear to my heart, or maybe more accurately, my wife's heart, to the Dalhai girls tennis team. A wonderful accomplishment, amazing every year. Year after year, how strong that program is, and congratulations to the girls. They really had to work hard to get that. And then, lastly, tonight, I guess is appropriate time for me. I will be announcing that I will run for re-election this time around. I know you guys were wondering if I was going to or not, and yes, I will be. I submitted my paperwork to Cindy tonight, and so I will be running again. Hopefully, people will want me to serve.
Well, Mike, if you're going to stick around, I think I am too. I've also turned in my paperwork today.
Very good.
And if it's the will of the voters, then I'll be here for another term. Congratulations to our graduates. I was at Midland this year, and for the first time in 4 years, it was fun. It was a lot of fun to be in a new school and a new environment and to just shake the kids' hands as they walked across the stage. Rachel has taken on an immense project with hiring all these teachers. Congratulations to her and Chad for their Shining Star Awards. The budget, I guess, just like the last three times we've talked about it, is encouraging. Everybody has done a wonderful job, I think, helping us sleep better at night, knowing that we're heading the right direction. And so I guess I will leave it at that.
Well, I would like to say to everybody, have a great summer. Have a nice break, get all rested and relaxed for school to start again, because it'll come around quickly. Also, I'd like to say to all our retiring teachers, congratulations on your retirement, and thank you so much for your years of dedication to your profession, to your students, and to Midland Public Schools. And thanks to Bob for all his hard work on the budget. That was very nice. That was great. And also, I think we have to remember to say a big thank you to everybody who did make concessions, who worked so hard to get us to where we are today. We really, I think we need to really appreciate that a lot. I think that's all I have to say.
Great. Well, it was wonderful to be a part of the graduation ceremony at Midland High, and I heard wonderful things about Dow High's graduation as well. Always a great event. And I look forward to hearing the speakers every year. Celebrate summer break for all of our kids, with Thursday being the last day of school. I know my seventh grader is super excited for a little break. Just a reminder to parents that there are some great camp opportunities here in Midland County and around the area. The tour as Central Park Elementary, it's wonderful to see the huge progress that's being made, and I look forward to watching over the summer and seeing even more progress. Many Midland High and Dow High students mourned the loss of students this past week, and it was very heartwarming to see the student bodies of each school come out in such support, and it really makes me feel like this is truly a family. Midland Public Schools is a family, and the students and staff and everybody circled around to support these families. So kudos for that, and their memories will stay with us. That's all I have.
Thank you, Pam. All right, so just to reiterate, I think everyone else, thank you very much to our Shining Stars tonight. It's interesting with all the teachers retiring, and I know I had some concern, and my daughter came home from school a couple weeks ago. We were concerned about a class she's taking next year because fabulous teacher who's retiring, but my daughter came home all excited because apparently word's out on a new teacher that we're hiring, and she came home so excited for next year already, and I just love that. Whoever leaked that information there at the school, I appreciate it. So there was that. Yes, graduation was fabulous. I made it through with no Kleenexes. I'm unbelievable. And so yeah, a great night. Yeah, and like you said, I heard Midland High's was fabulous too, and now the graduation parties, finals this week, 3 more days. So good luck to all the kids taking finals. I know that ends up being a very stressful time for some of them. And also to highlight today in our Monday communique that there are, was it 4 or 5 places in Midland that kids can go and get free lunch all summer if they would like. Yes. So highlight that. That was good to read in there. And then once again, thank you to everybody who's worked so hard to get us where we're at for this budget. Really, really appreciate all the hard work. Everyone's had a piece of it, and I think that's what we've realized, is that there weren't any big hitters anymore, that it was going to take everybody doing a little bit to get us where we needed to be. So I really appreciate everybody's hard work. All right.
I have a couple items for you tonight. As you know, we've been busy doing a lot of interviewing, a lot of hiring, and so we've filled all of our administrative positions at this point. So we have Julie Villano, who's presently filling in at Jefferson for assistant principal. We'll be moving over to Dow High with Mr. Poole, and in her place we're going to be hiring Tila Sherman, and she's coming to us from Arizona, so she'll be the AP at Jefferson. And we have Jennifer Coppins, who is in the area presently, once started her career early, I think, in Midland Public Schools, and is a middle school principal, will be coming to Dow High as the AP over there. And Keith Seibert will be AP at Northeast Middle School. And we have hired the 0.5 AD position at Dow High as well, and that is John Streeter, who's on staff there doing PE. He'll do half day PE and half day AD going forward. So congratulations to all of them as we go forward. You already heard about Meal Magic tonight, so I won't talk about that one. And I've talked to you a little bit about something you probably are really excited about, but the state law requires all of you to be trained on a new evaluation tool for the superintendents. And I've sent you a little bit of information lately,
right,
where I think we were leaning to the MASB product, which is not going to be approved. So MASB and MASA has worked with the vendor of School Advance, because the product is very research-based and very driven, but it's not the easiest to use. And so MASB and MSA's promise to all of us is that they're going to make that an easier product to use. And that last email today, if you haven't had a chance, they kind of mentioned that in there. If you read in there, it's going to get a little easier. But if you've looked at the product, it's mind-boggling. And so what I know of districts who use it, they often adapt it after they go through training. And so instead of trying to set our own training and pay for that, We have it being done through a grant, it's, but it's at Claire Gladwin on the September 14th and December 14th. It's two nights of training. I have to be trained along with all of you eventually, but what we can do is to use the trainer model, and so we could send some of you who would train the rest of them and hopefully have the historical knowledge mm-hmm. as you go forward. So just need maybe Angela to do a voice vote with you guys, yeah, on the phone and say, do you want to go, or do, okay. should I just grab a committee
right,
that
right.
we already have and say, you three are going mm-hmm. to these long nights in Claire Gladwin. So
well, there were two different there were two different chunks of dates, right? Wasn't one October-ish and one December-ish?
At Claire Gladwin, it's only September 14th, December 14th.
Oh, it's the only time.
Yeah, yeah. But it's 2 days. It wasn't like one or
it's
the
not
other.
One or the other. You have to go
yeah.
both.
I know it's 2 days. Okay.
Right.
So.
September
we can
14th.
Figure that one out as we go. We get some yeah. time, but I just want to okay. let you know and come back and train you. And then I think you guys will probably spend some time together, maybe through Angela's lead, about just what all the product can you use and not use, or go through as go through there. The auditorium, we do meet with our user groups tomorrow. Again, on the next step of it, they have the early design yet to be still changed, design based on dollars and wants. And so we'll meet with them. Then the final design will be completed in August. We'll meet with user groups one more time, and then it'll go out to bid early in the fall for it to be worked on through the winter as well. So we're getting closer on the auditorium. Staffing, we've been, Cynthia, I got a chance to talk to her today, first time in a week, I think. She said in more interviews than anyone in the district. But we are very getting much closer to our filling our teaching positions as well. And I don't want to put a number on it, but I think it's 60-70% that we're filled of those 40-some positions. And there'll be some straggling positions, as you know, that'll mm-hmm. go right into the summer because of how we piece them together, those going forward. But we're making very good progress there. I also wrote to you about reinvesting the bond funds, and there's various reasons to do it. I didn't want to mention a whole lot when we were visiting Central Park, but work has progressed much faster mm-hmm. than the actual expenditure schedule. And so we haven't told them that because we don't want to have to pay them any earlier, but we really don't want to delay that project much. And so we were looking for some liquidity or flexibility in it. And so when we talked to our investing group about it, they came up with a different product that would give us that, but also would make us about 40, am I saying that, Bob, correct, basis, 40 basis points was it, the estimate? Okay. So if you understand basis yep. points or not, but it 20 basis points, it would get us quite a bit more investment. Now, we don't get more money to spend more money, but it helps taxpayers in the sense that it'll lower that millage rate mm-hmm. or pay it off early, mm-hmm. which is all beneficial to the community. And it would give us more cash flow at the time to continue their progress, because what you really want to do is you want them to make as much progress during the summer months as they can.
Yep.
That they get that building closed
yep.
in
yes.
and work inside
yep.
when the weather
yep.
comes. So it's still secured, done a little bit different through collateral, and the banks own it. The other piece that we had talked about a little bit is hopefully you're aware that Chemical, Talmer Bank are becoming one, with it really being Chemical. Talmer's pretty big in the southeast where I came from, and Talmer is the one that's offering this special kind of deal. We will bid it. Chemical will have the opportunity to bid it, but we really don't expect Chemical probably to do it because Chemical is going to consume Talmer in a short period of time. But that's yet to be known as well. So being local, Talmer's a Michigan bank, Chemical's a Michigan bank, but Chemical's in our backyard. And so hopefully, either way, Talmer's becoming Chemical if we go through with this. So, and remember, we're really talking about two years, so
yeah.
it's not something you're investing for a long period of
yep.
time. In 2 years, Series 1's bonds mm-hmm. will have been spent off at that mm-hmm. point, and we'll be selling Series 2. I think we're pretty good on that one. That's all I have, and Andrew, remember we're going in the closed before parent negotiations.
Okay. All right, so at this time, I think we need to take a motion to go into closed session.
Yes.
I move to go to closed session.
All right.
Support.
Jerry, support by Scott. Any discussion? All right. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right. At this time, we will ask everyone else to leave. If everyone could please turn off their microphones.
For those of you leaving, we don't expect this to be a real long closed session.
So 5 minutes.